This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host. Very excited to have a friend on this show, Robby Apple. Hey, Robby, how are you?
Hey, Gary, I'm doing great. Thank you for having me.
Oh, man, this is going to be a real treat for our listeners. Let me share with our listeners what our topic is. It's a very important topic, and we're going to talk about the latest tax reform bill and what that means to dentists. Now, wait a minute. Just before any of you, you know, turn off your phone and you're thinking, oh, my gosh, an entire podcast on a tax reform bill. I actually made a very conscious decision to invite Robby on as my guest because he is the one guy on the planet that can actually make this topic interesting. Okay, Robby, I put you on the spot. What do you think?
You set the bar high, but I'm going to see what I can do.
Robby is an accountant by profession, by trade. He's my friend, and he understands this new tax bill very well. And I promise you, we are going to make this interesting. So this will not be a podcast you need to listen to if you've got insomnia and you're trying to go to sleep. This will actually be a very interesting podcast. So
we'll dive off into some fun football talk and golf, as it always does.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Hey, Robby is a principal in an accounting firm in Louisiana, and his firm is also a member of the ADCPA. The Academy of Dental CPAs. That's an organization that I'm very fond of. And Robby, let's talk a little bit about ADCPA. I imagine that there's many of our listeners that have never heard of the ADCPA, although collectively, your academy represents the member accounting firms in the academy represent over 9,000 dentists in the United States. Do I have that number about right?
That number's about right. It's a growing number, thankfully. We have 28 member firms throughout the country, spanning from California on the West Coast all the way to New York and up in New England. We're in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. There's quite a few in the heartland as well. Very geographically diverse, and we get together a few times a year. You had the pleasure of getting together at one of our more fun locations in Huntington Beach a couple of months back. To talk about what are the newest issues in the dental world.
Yeah, we got to hang out together in Huntington Beach and play some golf and some volleyball, and actually some very educational sessions went on with your members about just the different accounting issues and developments that affect dentists. Talk a little bit, if you would, Robby, talk a little bit about the ADCPA. So if any of our listeners are new and not familiar with the ADCPA, I think it's important that they know about them. I'll put a link in the show notes for the website for the ADCPA. It's actually just like it sounds, adcpa.org. I'll put a link in the show notes so that any of our listeners can go there and do more research themselves. But if you would, share a little bit about the ADCPA.
Well, I think the place to start there is with what is a dental CPA. A lot of your listeners and a lot of the general public, even the general dental public, doesn't know what a dental CPA is. And really, what we qualify that as is a CPA who services more than 50 dentists. Takes some special time to really learn the ins and outs of the business of dentistry, stays up on current tax law changes, because that's what we always do as CPAs, but also just business changes, things to do with DSOs, insurance changes. Many of the things that you go around lecturing about are the things that we try to stay up on as well.
Right.
The majority of our firms in the ADCPA exclusively serve the dental public. So they are exclusively working with dentists, offices, specialists as well. And that's what they concentrate their entire business on.
Right. You know, I'll share a personal story with our listeners, Robby. You know, our listeners know that although I'm not a dentist, I do own a dental practice. And when I bought my practice in May of 2007, I have a longtime friend, mutual friend of ours, Robby, Art Wiederman. And
that's right.
Art is his firm in Orange County, California, was one of the original founding firms associated with the ADCPA. And I've known Art for almost 30 years. And our practice closed transactionally about 4 o'clock in the afternoon on a Friday afternoon in late April, 2007. And after the transaction closed, the very first phone call I made was to my friend, Art Wiederman. And I said, Art, you won't believe this, but I now own a dental practice. And can you please recommend an ADCPA member for my practice? And without hesitation, he recommended Bill Owens. I'll give a shout out to Bill. He recommended Bill Owens. And that was the next call that I made after Art, was to call Bill Owens. And we've worked with Bill and his firm ever since. And I have to tell you, they are a very important part of our advisory team.
I think that's a great testimonial.
Yeah, you know, I really love the way that your firms truly understand the nuances of dentistry. And, you know, many dentists, for example, you know, maybe they have an accountant that they connected with somehow in their community, or perhaps it could be associated with a fraternity buddy in college. And it's an accounting firm that you know, works with a wide cross-section of clients. And, you know, I certainly don't want to speak disparagingly about those, but perhaps they really don't understand the nuances of the details that dentists have to, you know, have to contend with. And that's one of the great things about the ADCPA. You guys have a deep knowledge about the challenges that dentists face in terms of their accounting. And as a result, can recommend solutions that are very much tailored to dentists.
I would agree with that. All of our members are very involved in the state associations. We as a group speak to over half the dental schools in the U.S. So we see guys right out of school all the way to calling it quits.
Yeah. If you would share a little bit about your firm in Louisiana.
Sure. We're located in Baton Rouge, which for those who didn't study their capitals real closely, we're the capital of Louisiana. We're about an hour north of New Orleans. We serve over 100 dentists, most of which are in Louisiana. The only dental school that we're speaking at currently is the LSU Dental School, where we speak to the seniors a couple of times a year.
You have a little bit of loyalty to a certain college football team down there in Louisiana as well. Is that correct?
I think a little bit of loyalty might be understating it. We kind of live by this stuff. We're falling on a little bit of hard times, but we are LSU Tigers through and through.
Yeah, you know, our listeners probably know that I'm a University of Oregon graduate. I'm a fighting duck. I do want to emphasize that, Robby, the fighting part. We're fighting. We're not just regular ducks. We're fighting ducks.
Yeah, fighting, of course.
just wanted to make that clarification. I know that you work in your firm with a wide cross-section of dentists, ranging from new graduates all the way to dentists, you know, on the other end of their career, those that are preparing their practice for retirement. And you work with a wide cross-section of dentists really at every stage of their career.
Absolutely. A lot of times we end up on both sides of the transaction in some way, shape, or form, where a new graduate and one of our older clients, they happen to be the perfect marriage of one's getting out, one's getting in. So, we definitely see the whole gamut of career.
Yeah. You know, and I want to, you know, give particular recognition to your firm as well as the other, ADCPA, member firms. And that is that you aren't just historians. You know, many accountants function as historians. And what I mean by that is they tell the dentist what happened. Well, that's useful. But it's even more useful if you can help, if you can serve more a consultative role with your dentist and help them affect the outcome in a more positive way. And I know that you take a consultative approach with your clients, and you actually work with them on how to improve their practice based on real-time performance, not just telling the dentist what happened. Is that an accurate way to describe that?
Absolutely. We really try to stay away from the old school CPA model of the I'm coming in once a year to get my taxes done. We want to be involved in your business on a monthly or quarterly basis, and we want to be kind of coaching you along the way. We want to tell you what kind of story the numbers are telling us, and let's see how we can change that story if we need to going forward.
Yeah, and I know that you know your clients' goals. You've worked with them to identify their goals, and you work with them to help them achieve their goals, which is often a very different relationship between the accountant and the dentist. And I really applaud your approach at taking that approach.
Well, thank you for that. It's a lot more rewarding for us as well. We love to see our clients succeed.
And Robby, if you would share with our listeners, what drew you to the dental profession?
Well, as I've shared with you, I personally am pretty much a dentist dream. I feel like there's a whole fleet of boats out there somewhere named after me based on all the dental work that I've had in my life. I've had multiple crowns. I've got an implant. I've had a couple of root canals. I had braces twice as a stubborn teenager who wouldn't wear his retainer. So I'm very, very familiar with dental offices. That started from an early age.
Sure.
If you don't mind, I'd like to tell you a little story for our pediatric dental listeners out there.
Sure.
So as most have issues with, at some point, the pediatric dentist has to say, okay, patient X, it's time for you to go see the adult dentist. And you hung out with me for a little while in Huntington Beach. You know that I'm not a big man, but I'm about an average size guy, about 5'8", 175, something like that.
Yep.
And the funny thing about that is that that's what size I was when I was 13 years old. And things stopped. They only start growing horizontally at that point.
So a D lineman for LSU, pretty much that dream was evaporated at about age 13 and a half.
That's right. I was playing center in basketball and football at that point, but no more center for Robby.
Right.
So I went to visit my dentist and I had to have a little bit of work done. My little brother was actually in the chair next to me and he gave me the injection, and I don't know what exactly compelled me to, but I felt a little funny and decided I needed to stand up. And the next thing I knew, I was laying on the floor, looking up at the ceiling, and my doctor had caught me in his arms. He's about the same size as me. And it turned out I didn't know that I had a case of mono at the time. And when he gave me the injection, just something felt wrong. And that was my last trip to the pediatric dentist.
I'm thinking he had a wonderful conversation with your parents saying it's time to find Robby a regular dentist.
I remember the conversation, and that was exactly how it went.
Yeah. Well, first of all, thank you for your humility and your honesty. It's much appreciated. I know there's listeners that are smiling and laughing because they've had patients just like you.
They're probably sizing up their patients right now, thinking who they might want to catch and who might be a problem. Right.
Well, and the good news is that you later evolved into a pretty good dental patient.
That's right.
It does. The story does have a nice ending to it.
I think so.
So from there, professionally, what was it that drew you and your firm to the dental profession?
Well, there's a lot of things about dental clients and dentists in general that make them very attractive clients for us and for all 80 CPA members and really all CPAs. They're, for the most part, intelligent people who want to learn. As you know from your time at dental school, they're really not taught a whole lot of business in school. So they come out making a nice income and really being responsible for running a business without any training.
Right.
We enjoy the teaching aspect of it, the mentoring, and also the things that they say, Robby, I would just really feel more comfortable if you just handled this for me.
Right.
That's also an acceptable answer. They're pretty accepting of advice, and many, many of our dentists are very entrepreneurial, especially probably a lot of your listeners, where our advice doesn't necessarily end with advising on the practice, which is also rewarding.
I'm glad you brought up that point, Robby, because I know that you personally and your firm, as well as the member ADCPA firms, believe strongly in encouraging the entrepreneurial spirit among dentists. And you're a voice. The ADCPA is a voice for entrepreneurism in dentistry. And sadly, there's a segment of our profession that doesn't feel like it's viable to own your own practice anymore. And I couldn't disagree more with that segment.
I'm completely with you. It's a great time to own a practice. Financing rates are unbelievable. Anytime a client comes in who is a non-dental client, I tell them what kind of rates dentists get on practices, that blows their mind. Everybody loves working with dentists. It's a great time to be looking at private practice.
Hey, Robby, can I roll back the way back reel for just a minute?
Absolutely.
I started this profession in 1980, and I think that was before you were even born, man. But anyway, in 1980, I had some clients that purchased a practice in 1980. Can I share with you what their interest rate on their loan was when they purchased a practice in 1980?
Well, this is going to be scary, but go ahead.
22%. Can you imagine that, Robby? 22%.
I really can't.
And by the way,
borrowing at 4 right now.
They made it. They made it. Despite that rather onerous start at 22%, right? They made it. And that was 1980. Of course, that was a very different economic time today. But hey, maybe that provides us a very nice transition into really the meat of this interview. Let's talk about the latest tax reform bill. And I'd like to start with your general thoughts. Can you share some of your thoughts on the latest tax reform bill? The ink is barely dry, you know, on the bill. In fact, I've actually seen it, you know, in print. And I can't even describe how thick the bill is. Can you describe it in terms of what it looks like?
I think
like?
It's 555 pages, something like that. I can honestly say I haven't printed it out. It would just be a little intimidating to have printed out on the desk.
Yeah, 500 plus pages. It is quite encompassing. Would you start by sharing a little bit about your thoughts about the latest tax reform bill?
I absolutely will. First thing I'd like to say is that all of this advice that I'm going to give today is very general. I would strongly encourage any of your listeners to speak to their current CPAs or if they feel they need to seek out new advisors about their personal situation. There's many variables in every tax situation, just like there's many variables to everyone's mouth. Everything is nuanced and unique. So the advice that I give will not be blanket advice, but
so kind of like
should
that,
at least be thought provoking.
Like that generic YouTube video advice. Don't try this at home yourself.
That's right. Or John Hamm on these H&R Block commercials with his tax write-offs.
Right.
It's a little bit more specific than
right,
that.
Right. Yeah. Good advice. And let me echo that, Robby, that if you're listening to this and definitely speak with your own advisors, if you feel like you want to upgrade your advisors, I couldn't recommend the ADCPA members anymore. Go to the ADCPA site and you can find a member firm there that can help you with this. But with that disclaimer being made, Robby, let's dive in.
Sure. So first, let me start by saying there's still a lot of questions out there. So Congress passes this big, complicated bill. There's not a lot of CPAs in Congress, mostly lawyers and career politicians. So they pass this bill and we have to interpret it as best we can. Slowly over time, the IRS starts issuing us some guidance on some of the things that we feel are a little bit gray. These take a little bit of time. So like you said, the ink is fairly dry on the bill. We'll wait to see some Internal Revenue Service bulletins, some letter rulings, and they issue something called a Rev Proc that kind of helps us to determine what were they really trying to accomplish and how is the IRS going to enforce this. So those will be coming over the next couple of months, and it'll be kind of interesting to see some of these pieces.
You know, what's interesting is historically, this kind of sweeping reform bill doesn't happen that frequently. In fact, talk about the last one.
Well, we've had very little change really since the Affordable Care Act in 2010, where the individual mandate for health insurance was put in and a number of new taxes were added. There weren't a whole lot removed at that time. And really, some people have argued that this is the biggest change since the 1986 rewrite during the Reagan era.
Yeah, so we're talking about, you know, this is kind of, you know, if we go back to the Affordable Care Act, that was 2010. Do I have the date right on that?
That's right.
So that was, you know, well, 8 years ago now. And then some would say that the last kind of wholesale change was back to the mid-80s, 1986 in the Reagan era. So, you know, we're talking about sweeping changes that don't happen all that often.
That's right. And I'll tell you, Gary, the Affordable Care Act days were not fun days to be a CPA who does some public speaking.
Oh, my goodness. I can imagine, you know, imagine the president of the dental society saying, hey, Robby, we'd like you to come talk to our association about the ACA. You had to be thinking in the back of your mind, I don't know.
Yeah, I almost wanted to say no. Nobody likes to hear a lecture about how they're going to have less money in their pockets and more compliance costs. And I kind of felt like the Grim Reaper by the end of those presentations.
Well, I'm sure you did a good job of those. You unfortunately didn't have much to work with. We're not going to get into politics on this this podcast, but let's just say that those lectures must have been challenging for you because you didn't have much good news there.
And this is a different situation. So I'm excited to talk about these things.
Yeah.
One of the goals that they had spelled out was to simplify. And I have to say, Gary, that's hilarious because this is very much not simple. You're not going to be doing your taxes by postcard. And when we get into some of the individual pieces, you'll see what I'm talking about. But simplification, I'm not sure that they really accomplished that.
Right. Right. Yeah. I love that, carrot that some politicians have put out there that say that, in the future, imagine a tax situation where you file your tax return in the form of a postcard. Well, we're not quite there yet.
As a CPA too, I'm not terribly worried about that. There are too many cooks in the kitchen who want their own lobby taken care of, or in my opinion, for that to happen anytime soon.
Yeah. I think you've got some job security, Robby. I believe that the latest tax reform bill, though, are really going to affect a lot of Americans. Is that an accurate projection?
They are. One interesting statistic that I've read was that they estimate the bill will increase the number of Americans who owe nothing in tax from 44% to 47.5%. And this is mostly due to the increase in the standard deduction, which I'll talk about, in the child tax credit. That could have some large economic impacts. As I'm talking, I think it's important for our listeners to think about not only themselves, but also their patients and how this might trickle down into their practices.
Hey, can I put you on the spot for just a minute, Robby?
Sure.
So if you had to take a position on the latest tax reform bill, and this is a difficult question because everyone's situation is different, would you say that it's largely good news for Americans, or is it bad news? If you had to take, I'm putting you on the spot. We didn't talk about this ahead of time. So I'm interested to hear what you say.
I would say largely short term. I feel it's very good news. I think it's going to result in more money in everybody's pocket. Hopefully it'll stimulate spending and continue to grow the economy. The stock market has received it very well. We've seen record highs on the reg recently.
That's true. The Dow at 25,000. That's an all-time high. We had the best start of a year in quite some time, and largely it's on the strength of the tax reform bill. Is that accurate?
I would say so. The big question that remains is if this will really pay for itself. So there's roughly $1.5 trillion of tax cuts. The idea is that the economic growth will make up for that cut, and we'll have to wait and see on that one. But I hope that we'll see more patients with more money in their pocket, more doctors with more money in their pocket. They may see an increase in things like elective procedures. Patients tend to come in and do things like whitenings and adult orthodontics when they feel better about their own personal financial situation.
You make an excellent point, Robby. And certainly you're in a part of the country in Louisiana that your economy, much like ours in Arizona, is affected by ups and downs. Now, we have different economic engines. In Louisiana, you have a lot of oil and gas impact on your economy. As oil and gas price goes up and down, your economy goes up and down. Is that a simplistic way to describe the Louisiana economy?
No doubt.
And in Arizona, it's things like construction and tourism that causes our economy to go up and down. But I think whether we're in Louisiana or Arizona, if consumers have confidence and they have more money in their pocket, it translates well to the dental profession. And I think we're about to enter an era where that's the case.
I think the confidence is the key. You have to believe that tomorrow is going to be better than today. And if you do, you're going to spend differently.
Yeah. Yeah. I like your crystal ball on that one, Robby. And I hope that remains true as we, as we proceed through time on this one. Let's get specific. Can you talk about some specifics of the new tax reform that might affect Dennis and our listeners?
Absolutely. And I'm going to try to do my best to talk about some different ranges so that kind of hit as many of your listeners as possible. The biggest thing is that the tax rates went down in every single bracket for individuals. So every individual will see some kind of relief based on just the brackets going down. As an example, the 25% bracket essentially became a 22% bracket. And what that means in layman's terms is if you have $1,000 of income in that bracket, you're going to pay $220 in tax rather than $250 in tax.
I like that trend.
That's $30 more in your pocket, right? Even a simple person could do that math.
Yep. Yep.
They expanded the size of the brackets as well to include more income at the lower rates. And the top tax bracket moved from about $470,000 to $600,000. So you will have a lot more folks falling into those lower income brackets before they get all the way to the top bracket. And that top bracket went down from 39.6% to 37%. So really, the tax brackets changes are really all good.
To put that in the context of our listeners, as you know, Robby, we have a wide cross section of listeners from, really from dental students all the way to dentists at the senior end of their career looking at retirement. But if we have a young dentist that perhaps is just starting their career, they're going to experience a lower tax bracket. And let's take a mid-career dentist that is really starting to put some pieces together and increase their income, they're going to see a lower tax bracket. Down to senior practitioners that are also experiencing success, they're going to see a lower tax bracket. So
that's right. It's across the board. I'd like to give you some concrete examples if I could.
Please do.
Okay. So for example, if you have one of those new grads who, or this may be a little bit above a typical new grad salary, let's use $200,000 of taxable income as our example. Under the old brackets, they would have paid about $43,000 in tax. In these new brackets, they're more around $36,000 for savings of $6,306. And that's a 3.2% increase. That's pretty significant.
Wow. That is. And if you look at the compounding effect of that over time, that can make all the difference in the world in terms of, retirement planning and achieving financial independence.
Without a doubt. And another example at $400,000. On the old way, they're around $107,000 of tax. With the new brackets, around $91,000, a savings of $15,800, 4% savings on their money. And I think we'll see a lot of these people reinvesting this money in equipment, in expansions. And I think it's a great time to be a dentist.
Yeah, awesome. I love your message.
You're an optimistic man. I am too, Gary.
Guilty as charged. I will admit that. But I love what you're seeing in the in the latest tax reform bill and how it translates into good news for all of our listeners.
I do have some bad news to get to later, but let's stick with the good news for now.
Yeah, let's keep rolling on it.
So one of the other provisions is increasing the standard deduction. They essentially doubled it, meaning that everyone, regardless of charitable contributions or mortgage interest, they'll still have this larger deduction available. And this is a big reason for that 44% to 47.5% of folks who won't pay anything. This is a large reason why, because most of these folks weren't itemizing to begin with. So they essentially got some free deductions.
Right. It went from 12,000 to 24.
That's roughly correct.
Yep. Yeah. Awesome.
One thing that they did away with in conjunction with that was the personal exemption. So the old rule was you had a roughly $4,000 deduction for each person you claimed in your household. So this was husband, wife, children. If you had elderly parents living with you who you were supporting, those are some examples. And this has been removed. Mm-hmm. And the increased standard deduction should compensate for some of this.
Right.
One big one that I think is actually being undersold in the media a little bit is the child tax credit increasing. The old rule, the child tax credit was about $1,000 per child. And if your joint income as a married couple exceeded $120,000, you phased out of this deduction, meaning the IRS said you made too much money, you're not allowed to take that deduction. Last minute, Marco Rubio is getting credit for slipping this provision in to increase the child tax credit to $2,000, and they bumped the phase outs up significantly for a married couple all the way up to $400,000. So for our younger dentists starting families, most of them were not receiving the child tax credit, and a lot will now. So I think this is a great provision.
Excellent. you're also, I want to get into this in a little bit detail. My favorite section of the Tax Act was Section 179, and I understand that got a lot better.
You sound like a Patterson or Shine rep right now.
I sound like a practice owner, I believe.
That too.
Because, if you use that section properly, it allows you to invest in your practice and get some favorable tax treatment regarding investing in your practice. And we at LifeSmiles believe in, our approach, and this is useful for you to hear, Robby, and also our listeners. We want to take care of patients the way we'd like to be taken care of. That means we want to have all the technology available that we'd like to have if we were a patient. And Section 179 allows you to invest in your practice and in turn get some favorable tax treatment. Would you mind just explaining that? What Section 179 is, in case we have listeners that aren't familiar with that?
Sure. So if you purchase, let's say, a CRAC machine, $100,000 CRAC machine, and you purchase it and it is placed in service in your business before December 31st of that tax year, you are allowed to deduct 100%, assuming you have the profits, 100% of that purchase. So you receive a $100,000 write-off. It defrays a lot of the cost of buying that machine. And you may pay for it over time, but you're still allowed to.
So you can take it that year. So in other words, you can take it that year, despite the fact that you may lease it or finance it over time, you can take that deduction in the year that you place it in service.
That's right. It has to be placed in service, not ordered, but placed in service that year. And what they did with the new law, the old rule was that you could do up to $500,000 of equipment, which most dentists are not going over, but maybe some of your larger practices were. They increased that limit to $1 million.
Nice. Very nice.
I think your equipment salesmen have probably heard this, and they may have some new deals for you.
Now, were there any categories that were added to one section? Typically we think of, equipment, dental type equipment, like you said, like CAD-CAM dentistry or lasers or, dental equipment. But were there other categories that were expanded?
That's a great question. Prior to this law, it had pretty much been furniture and equipment was mm-hmm. what qualified for this. They did add some things. They added now a roof can qualify for 179, an HVAC system, and alarm and security systems, a few things like that, that many building owners, which a lot of our dentists are, have to deal with this routine maintenance. And that's a big help.
Excellent. Again, further justification for why you need a really good advisor to help you with this and someone that understands dentistry because of some of the unique equipment required in dentistry.
Very expensive equipment. Mm-hmm. And a lot of it's revenue generating. It's important. It's what you need in your practice. It's money well spent. But let's get our tax deductions as well.
Right, right. Very cool.
One other thing that I'd like to hit on was that most dental practices that we see are typically flow through entities. And what that means is that they're S corporations or partnerships or LLCs in general. And they made some changes to this. I don't want to dive too deep here because it's pretty complicated, but they made a special provision for flow through entities whose taxable income is below $315,000. And you can actually get part of it up to $415,000. That allows them to exclude 20% of the flow through income from taxable income.
Oh, okay.
This is pretty unprecedented. We've never had a provision like this in the law unless it was back in the 20s or something. So it'll be very interesting to see what the guidance on this is. To give you kind of a numbers example, I know we love numbers. If you had $200,000 of income from your practice and your taxable income as a family were $315,000, you'd be able to exclude 20% of that $200,000. Which is $40,000 less in income, essentially a $9,600 savings in tax.
Wow.
That's a pretty big provision, especially with how many of our companies are set up this way.
Right, right. I'm going to ask a dangerous question because there's so many different situations, but is there a recommended structure or format for dentists today in terms of their business structure based on the new tax act, or is it so dependent on the circumstances that there's not a generic answer?
Now is a very good time to evaluate that. It certainly has thrown a couple more wrinkles in. The C corporation has basically been a dead horse to us for the last few years. The only companies that we see as a C corporation were very old established practices that couldn't make the conversion to S or change into some other format. And the reason that you wanted to change them was because the corporate tax rate was so high. With the new reform, we've reduced that corporate tax rate down to 21%, and that kind of changes our thoughts on them a little bit. The aim of this was really to repatriate some of those dollars for some of the bigger companies to keep them here for jobs, I believe, and not necessarily for smaller companies like dental offices, but that doesn't mean you can't benefit from it. We don't see a whole lot of these, like I said, Gary, and they still didn't cover the issue of double taxation on these. So I've gotten that question a lot over the last couple of weeks is, should I consider becoming a C corporation? And we always support evaluating everything. Right. Everything's on the table, but I don't think we're going to see a widespread flocking to C corporations still.
Right. And is that mainly because of the way you're getting taxed on the retained earnings?
That's exactly right. So you pay 21% on the earnings of the corporation. The hard part after that is you have to get whatever's left out to the owners still. And you either do that in the form of compensation, which is tax at personal rates, so you're not getting any benefit really there, or dividends. And that total combined rate is really, they made it much closer to the personal rates, which I believe was one of the goals of the bill. But it's not significantly better.
But imagine this. Imagine that there's one of our listeners that is a new doc, and in 2018, they get into a position to buy their own practice, and they buy a practice. This would be a great time. If they were in Louisiana, this would be a brilliant time for them to meet with you, Robby. And
that's right.
You could then sit down with them and really evaluate their situation to suggest what business structure. And when I say business structure, what I'm talking about is whether they should be, you know, a subchapter S, a partnership, an LLC, perhaps even a C corp. And you could really look at that, and you could really render advice based on their unique situation that would, you'd be able to tell them what the best business entity was for them. Is that correct? Is that an easy way to say that?
It is. And we love doing it on the front end because it's much easier to set it up correctly at the beginning than it is to change something old, as anybody listening who has an old C corporation can tell you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if you're in that situation, now is a great time to meet with your advisors and have that business structure question evaluated so you can be in the best structure. And we're not talking about minor savings here. This can make a massive difference in your tax situation and, you know, in your net income after taxes. It can make a big difference.
Huge difference. Huge difference in your life. We see a lot of stressed out dentists who are living paycheck to paycheck, unfortunately, and something that can save you $15,000 a year in taxes will impact your life.
Yeah. Well, Robby, my grandmother taught me to be very pragmatic and be very practical. You've talked about some good things here. Now, something tells me that there may be a little bit of a catch. There may be some provisions in the tax code that aren't necessarily the best news. Is that accurate? Was Grandma right?
I knew I was going to have to talk about those. So they had to come up with a way to pay for all these cuts, right? They didn't really cut spending a whole lot. So we have to remove some deductions to pay for some of these tax cuts. A few examples that I have, the domestic production activities deduction was repealed. This was really made for manufacturers to try to keep them in America.
Right.
The dental CPA world has decided, and I think rightfully so, that Cerec machines and some people manufacturing dentures, we're manufacturers. We don't think of ourselves because we're not at an assembly line as manufacturers, but those people are manufacturing items. So we've been taking deductions on those tax returns, and they repealed that with this new bill. Another that went away that will especially affect those living in higher income tax states with high state income taxes is that they capped the state and local taxes amount at $10,000. So the old rule would allow you to deduct all of your state income taxes on your federal tax return, as well as all property taxes that you paid. Now they say $10,000 total, that's where it stops. Mm-hmm. In a high income state like California, for example, who some people pay 12%, 12.5% on their state income, that can be a big difference. So the question is, does losing that deduction get offset by the reductions in rates?
Right. Right. very important if you happen to be in a state with high taxes.
That's right. And those can be property taxes too.
Right.
Property taxes included as well. Another one is that they are no longer allowing a deduction for entertainment expenses. So if the entertainment was for a business purpose, previously this was a deductible expense. An example, Gary, me and you go and play golf. Mm-hmm. If I pick up the tab, we talk about the Thriving Dentist Show. We talk about the ADCPA. The purpose of us going to play golf was to talk business. That was a deduction up until 12/31/17, essentially. And they have outlawed this.
So that one really may affect a lot of dentists.
From the tax returns we see, I would say yes, especially our specialists who have to kind of keep those referral pipes greased. Mm-hmm. We kind of think that they may see a hit. One thing that they did keep is that business meals are still 50%. So Okay. You may see a lot more Ruth's Chris steaks than golf rounds.
There we go. there we go. Well, it's just something to be mindful of for sure.
Absolutely. Another deduction that they did away with that really is kind of hitting us hard is they did away with the 80% deduction for university athletic seating rights. And what this was every year you paid, I'll use our LSU as an example, roughly $1,000 per seat for a season ticket in most places. You were required to make a $2,000 donation to the Tiger Athletic Foundation. But the catch on that was you got to deduct 80% of that donation as a charitable contribution.
I think this one's going to affect a lot of dentists.
Yeah. So they've done away with that. We see more of these donations. It's $100 to the church and $2,000 to the Tiger Athletic Foundation. Right. So this is going to be a big one. And I'm really interested to see how it affects college football. Jimbo Fisher over at Texas A&M just got $10 million a year. We just signed Dave Aranda, our defensive coordinator, to a $2.5 million contract, the highest paid coordinator in the country. If season ticket sales slip because people lose this tax deduction, I wonder how they're going to keep paying these guys these crazy amounts.
Yeah, you know, I don't think there'll be too many tears shed for Jimbo.
I don't either. And Gary, as Oregon alum, we all wish we could have somebody like Uncle Phil to bankroll our program. He may have to pony up a little more too. I'm sure that'll affect him hard.
Yeah, Uncle Phil Knight has been a wonderful contributor to Oregon athletics, and this may affect him a little bit too. But again, I don't think anyone's going to shed too many tears for Uncle Phil. I think he'll do just fine.
I agree with you. Another provision they did away with that may affect some listeners is moving expenses were previously deductible as long as you moved more than 50 miles away from your prior home for a job. They've done away with that deduction. Mortgage interest deductibility. Everybody has always been able to deduct the mortgage on their home up to $1 million loan. They changed this to $750,000.
Depending on where they are in the
going forward,
depending on where our listeners are in the country, that may affect them based on home values, huh?
Oh, absolutely. There's places where this affects everybody.
Mm-hmm. I'm thinking of California and the coastal areas, large urban areas. It looks like there'll be less deductibility on interest obviously it'll be capped at 750 instead of the million that it was before.
And the old rule still applies for any loan entered into before 12/15/17. So okay. If you already had, say, a $900,000 mortgage, you're still your grandfathered in.
Right. Yeah. Excellent.
Another is unreimbursed employee business expenses. So I particularly think of associates in this situation. Mm-hmm. If you itemize your deductions and you had significant expenses that you were responsible for paying, your employer didn't help you out with them, reimburse you. These are your responsibility. Some examples of that we see commonly are your continuing education, your license, perhaps your insurance, dues to the state societies, maybe your business use of your cell phone to call patients at night, some mileage if you travel between multiple locations.
Sure.
All of these things, if you're a W-2 employee, are no longer deductions. They've eliminated the unreimbursed employee business expenses.
So, again, a very important question to ask your advisor is, whether it makes sense for an associate to be a 1099 contractor.
And there's benefits to the employer and the employee in that situation. There are some other factors that you want to determine, but it'll be interesting to see whether more things go towards 1099, as there appear to be a few more benefits. These things are all still deductible if you're a 1099 contract associate. So it'll be very interesting to see if that creates waves.
Right. Well, so far we've talked about, you know, some of the positive things, some of the things that were obviously in a very positive situation for most of our listeners. We've talked about some things that, you know, maybe are on the negative side that have gone away, but there's got to be also some provisions that didn't change at all regarding once the final bill was passed. Is that true? Were there a number of things that stayed constant?
There absolutely were. One of which, a couple that will probably affect some new grads who might be listening. Student loan interest is still deductible up to $2,500 a year, subject to phase outs. These phase outs are painfully low. Married filing jointly, it's $160,000 of combined income, and individuals $80,000. I really wish that they would have increased those phase out amounts, because very few of our dentists are able to deduct their student loan interest. And yeah, that's an unfortunate surprise many times that first year that they're out making a full year's salary.
Right, right.
Another, they didn't change anything on the lifetime learning credit. So this is the education credit that's available to anyone who's receiving education after their first 4 years of college, so i.e. dental school. Mm-hmm. This is a non-refundable credit, meaning that you have to have tax offset with it. So the ones that I usually see, and there are a lot that fall into this category, is somebody who has a working spouse. So an example, I have a good friend of mine whose wife is a nurse, helping him through dental school. She's got income, thus has income tax, is able to use this $2,000 credit to offset some of her tax and get the family a larger refund.
Right, right.
That went unchanged. So that's another positive. Retirement plans didn't change a whole lot. This is still one of the best ways to shelter your income from income tax, totally legally. You can contribute up to $18,500 into a 401k. They talked at times about reducing this all the way down to $2,400, which we just couldn't imagine that would possibly happen. The 401k lobby is way too strong, and it kind of takes some of the personal responsibility of saving out of the equation.
Right.
So this remained largely unchanged.
You know, and again, I want to emphasize this, that the ability to use the appropriate retirement plan, whether that be a 401k, it could be a money purchase pension plan, it could be a defined benefit plan, can greatly enhance your ability to achieve financial independence. But you really need the advisor. You need great advice from advisors that understand your situation to determine what the best format is for you.
And you need to start early. Start as early as you can. Let that stuff compound.
Right, right. Right. So really, what I'm hearing you say is that retirement plans largely remained unchanged in the new act.
That's correct.
Yeah. Okay.
That's correct. Capital gains rates and dividends were also unchanged. So for investments, kind of in the same vein as retirement plans, investments for the most part remained unchanged.
Right. Right.
And even though we tried, we could not get the alternative minimum tax repealed. This is a very complicated calculation to figure out if you pay AMT, but if you're out there and you pay AMT, you probably know you do, and I'm sure you hate AMT. Right. So they did increase the exemption, so it should affect less people now, but it's still in the tax law.
Right. As you've started to talk to clients about this, I imagine you became very popular probably towards the end of December 2017, right, Robby?
I mean, for the first time, you're getting pulled aside saying, can I talk to you about taxes? Usually it's very painful to get somebody to sit down with me to talk about it. And now all of a sudden I'm a rock star at the gym. Everybody wants to pull me aside and ask me questions. It's been interesting.
Yeah, I bet. Good for you. You're getting your 15 minutes of fame. Good for you.
That's
well,
right.
Well deserved. What are some of the biggest misconceptions you've seen from your clients?
Well, not specific necessarily to this tax reform, but it would still apply. Is probably my biggest misconception is that there's no 100% tax rate. So it's always worth earning more, even if it means a percentage of this is going to have to go to Uncle Sam. I have some clients who are so afraid of making money because they're afraid of the taxes they're going to have to pay that they kind of get paralyzed and they say, do I really even want my business to expand? And the answer is yes, you absolutely want your business to expand. at the worst case scenario, let's say you have an additional $10,000 of income on your practice. You're at the very top tax bracket of 37%. That means $3,700 goes to Uncle Sam, but it means $6,300 stays in your pocket. So the idea is we want to help you minimize your taxes as best as possible, but we want to maximize our wealth. And I don't ever want to see a client who says, I don't know if I want to expand because it's going to cost me more taxes. It is going to cost you more taxes, but they're going to be a percentage. They're not going to be 100% of what you are.
You have to look at what's left, you know.
And, that's right.
You know, sadly, Robby, I often see dentists playing the wrong game. You know, for example, they're trying to play the no tax game. And, you know, they will go to extremes to play that game, to pay no tax, when in fact, those strategies really don't help enhance their net worth.
That's a great point. I often have that conversation with 179, actually, is this piece of equipment going to be an income producer for you? If you're just buying it for the tax savings, you're saving 35 cents by spending a dollar. That's still costing you 65 cents. Mm-hmm. So you have to make sure the equipment you're buying, the things that you're spending, you're getting a return on that. Otherwise, I'm going to keep my 65 cents.
Right. Yeah, and that's, again, why it's important to have a good advisor to help you play the right game in the first place.
That's right. We want low taxes, not necessarily no taxes. No taxes means we're not making any money, and that's no good either.
Sadly, some dentists have a nonprofit. They own a nonprofit, not by design.
Some, you might argue, are a charity as they're losing.
Well, and I hope they don't, you know, I hope that our listeners, the Thriving Dentist Show, fall into a different category. But, you know, it's one thing if you've created a nonprofit by choice, but you don't want to create a nonprofit by accident.
That's right. Another major misconception is a tax credit versus a tax deduction. A credit is something that is dollar for dollar reduction in taxes. So a $100 tax credit means you pay $100 less in taxes. Mm-hmm. These are normally for things you do, not necessarily for things you buy. For example, the child tax credit, like we talked about before, is just for having a child, or earned income tax credit is for working when you're in lower income. It's usually not something that you buy to receive the credit, at least not on the federal level.
Right.
A tax deduction is the more common thing that you buy, and it reduces your taxable income. So your savings, much like the 179 example I just gave you, is really whatever your rate is. So that is a very common misconception. And in general, if you can get a credit is better than a deduction.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, good point. Good point. And it does look like we've got maybe some favorable deductions out there, but fewer credits if I look at the bill closely.
Yeah, I would say a lot of what they did away with was deductions. There's still quite a few credits. The credits stayed fairly unchanged for the most part. If anything, they actually increased a few of them, but the deductions is really where they went to the chopping block.
All right. Oh, okay.
Another question I get a lot, especially from new grads, is if I establish an LLC and pay for things out of this LLC, they'll automatically become business expenses, correct? And the answer to that is not so much. The IRS kind of got hit to that. Everybody kind of knows that game, and where the item's paid for really doesn't change the nature of the expense. So it'd be a tough sell for you to sit across the table from an IRS auditor and claim that this boat you purchased is a ordinary and necessary business expense for your dental practice. The LLC is a smart move. I encourage people to establish LLCs, but it really doesn't change your tax deductions in any meaningful way.
Great point.
And especially with the entertainment expenses being excluded anyway, with this new bill, a lot of those items all fell under the entertainment category anyway. So I think we're going to see a little less of that.
Right.
And probably my favorite, Gary, is my friend, my sister, my brother-in-law, my cousin, my neighbor, my butcher, my yard guy does blank on his or her taxes. How do they do that? And why can't I? Reading an internet article, and again, I'll say every situation's different. There's a lot of misconceptions out there, a lot of risk takers who probably are taking deductions they shouldn't be. There's a lot of misconceptions. This is where a professional really pays their weight.
So are you just saying just because my cousin's best friend's hairdresser bought a boat and deducted it, I can't do that?
That's basically what I'm saying.
Hey, Robby, let's try to bring this to a close. First of all, thank you for all this awesome information. I should have made this comment earlier, but you've been kind enough to actually put all this discussion in note format. And we're going to make that available to our listeners. You've got quite a few pages of notes that you have put together for our listeners, and we're going to make that available. I'm going to put a link in the show notes so that you can get access to Robby's notes. So simply go to the show notes. It's at TACAS, T-A-K-A-C-S, learningcenter.com. Go to the show notes, click on the link, and you'll have free access to the notes. But as we're kind of coming into kind of the finish line here, talk about some closing thoughts related to the Tax Act.
Well, like I've kind of harped on throughout the presentation, I would seek out the help of a professional to evaluate your personal situation. Most taxpayers are going to be speaking with whoever prepares your taxes over the next 3 months anyway. So the timing is really pretty good. And I would just ask a simple question. Do you see anything with my return that'll be significantly different in 2018? It could be good news. It could be bad news. But as a taxpayer, I would want to be prepared for whatever that may be.
Right. You know, excellent. And then, of course, you know, as relates to 2018, you'll have time to put some things in place that would be maybe more favorable for you.
Certainly. The planning can start at that point. He may say, absolutely, I see a couple of pieces that could really, really help you. Let's make sure that we implement this before the end of the year. It may be something that you need to do in steps, and the guidance of a professional who's done this before could be just monumental.
Right. We've talked about ADCPA, but get more specific about how our listeners can find an ADCPA member.
Absolutely. If you're interested in finding out what a dental CPA can do for you, I'd encourage you to visit our website, adcpa.org. You can click on the Find a Member section, and we've got a nice map of the country to help you find the nearest ADCPA member to you. All the firms are very knowledgeable, and it probably makes sense to use whoever's nearest you geographically, but most of our firms do reach across the country.
Right. And again, I have personal experience of working with an ADCPA firm, Owens and Bondell, Bill Owens. I'll give him another shout out, you know, here in Phoenix. And Bill is just a wonderful, wonderful advisor. And I wouldn't want to practice without his counsel.
That's the greatest compliment you can give.
Yeah, great. And I know the principals of your accounting, of your membership, and these are just great people all over the country, just fantastic people that care deeply for their clients, pride themselves on staying up on all the latest advances, and just really a first-class group of people to work with.
We appreciate you saying that.
Yeah. I want to thank you, Robby, for taking a difficult topic and actually making it interesting. You did an awesome job. Would you be kind enough to share your website address of your firm for our listeners?
Sure will. Our address is agdentalcpas.com. That's agdentalcpas.com. There's a contact us tab in there. If you'd like to send us an email and have one of our CPAs reach out to you, we'd be happy to talk to you about your situation.
Would you mind sharing your email address as well?
Not at all. It's rapple, like the fruit, at applegurin.com. That's where the AG comes from.
Spell that one more time.
AppleGuerin, GUERIN.com. We've got all these crazy French names down here.
I'm going to put your email address in the show notes. And again, that's Robby, R Apple, just spelled like the fruit, APPLE, at AppleGuerin.com. And Guerin is spelled GUERIN.com. Do I have that correct?
You got that right.
Hey, I'm going to put that in the show notes. Let me invite you as a listener to reach out to Robby. And hey, if you either enjoy LSU football, send him an email. And if you're not so much an LSU fan, send him an email and spark a debate. Maybe if you're an Oregon fan.
Here right now, Gary, that might be a hard one to defend, but I'll see what I can do.
Well, I can guarantee you that it will be an enjoyable conversation. Robbie's a classy guy, and you know, he does have his SEC loyalty, and I feel a little bit differently about that from graduating from Oregon and being a Pac-12 fan. But regardless of what your college football persuasion is, reach out to Robby, send him an email, thank him for sharing this great information with you. And hey, if you've never been to the great state of Louisiana, you now have a friend in Louisiana. And hey, perhaps maybe someone would like to go down there and visit you and maybe sometime in the fall and actually experience an LSU football game. I think our good friend Art Wiederman did that with his son Forrest this past fall, didn't he?
He did. And we showed him a heck of a time.
I heard that it was nothing short of epic.
He didn't even get to see a night game either. The night games are where it really gets epic.
So in all seriousness, reach out to Robby and just say thanks, man. Robby, I want to thank you for your wisdom. I want to thank you for your passion. I want to thank you for your professionalism, your commitment to our amazing profession. Thanks for all that you and your partners and your team members do. We appreciate you, man.
Well, thank you so much, Gary, for having me on. I hope I made this as entertaining as possible, but I think there's some very valuable information in there for your listeners.
And again, if you want the summary, I think you've got a number of pages that very simply and accurately summarizes what we talked about. Simply go to the show notes. There'll be a link to receive that. It's absolutely free. We can thank Robby for that. Go to the link in the show notes, click that, and you'll immediately receive a digital copy of those notes. Robby, thank you for preparing those in advance. I know you went through quite a bit of work to do those, to prepare the notes. Thank you so much for doing that.
500 down to 3 or 4. That's pretty good.
Yeah, you're saving them about 500 plus pages of reading by getting the Reader's Digest condensed notes. How about that?
The Cliff Notes. That's right.
The Cliff Notes. That's right. The Apple Notes. How about we call them that? The Apple Notes.
I'm good with that.
All right. Well, hey, I want to take a minute and thank our listeners. We appreciate each and every one of you at the Thriving Dentist Show. Try to never forget that we couldn't do what we do if it wasn't for you. There's three ways you can support our work. Number one, you can tell a colleague. You probably have many dentists that you know that have never heard the word podcast. Tell them about podcasts and tell them about the Thriving Dentist Show. Second thing that you can do is you can write us a review. You can go on iTunes and write us a review. That'll help more dentists be able to find us. If you haven't done that, let me make a request. Go to iTunes and write a review for the Thriving Dentist Show. Third thing that you can do is you can hit the subscribe button. You can do that on iTunes, or you can do that on Google Play if you're an Android person, or you can do that on whatever your podcast directory of choice is. Simply hit subscribe. That means every Wednesday when we upload a new show will automatically be uploaded for your listening convenience. It's completely free to subscribe. On that note, let me simply say thank you and tell you I will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.